The Battle of France is over. The Battle of Britain is about to begin.
It's the summer of 1940. Hitler's forces are poised to invade Britain, and all that stands in their way are the men and women of the Royal Air Force.
As wave after wave of enemy bombers make their way towards Britain, commanders desperately try and figure out where they will strike next.
But this isn't the familiar story of the Battle of Britain, one of tactics, machines, and famous names.
Over three nights, we're going to explore the lost and forgotten tales of the operations room workers, ground crews, and pilots who put their lives on the line to defend Britain.
I've all heard of the Battle of Britain, but they've never heard of Archie MacKellar.
We'll uncover forgotten documents that reveal the human cost of the battle.
I guess he takes one out before it...
And relive moments of heroism.
Even when my grandmother was talking about it at the age of 94, it always brought a tear to her eye.
Over the next three nights, we're going to follow three pivotal days from the Battle of Britain.
The first is the 15th of August 1940, when Hitler's attacks began in earnest.
The second is the 30th of August, the RAF's most intense day of fighting. Britain's airfields are bombarded and defeat seems imminent. And the third is the 15th of September, when Britain's exhausted defenders gamble everything to win the battle.
We'll be telling the story in minute-by-minute detail.
From Scotland to the West Country, Kent to the north of England, we'll discover what it was like as the whole country came under attack. As we retrace the battle in the air...
If that was real, we'd have been hit full on.
...and on the ground.
Aircraft at 15.
It was the greatest battle the RAF ever fought.
But at its heart were the people. This is the story of their Battle of Britain.
It's 6 a.m., the 15th of August, 1940. The Battle of Britain began 5 weeks ago, on the 10th of July. Up until now, Hitler has mostly focused his air raids on the southeast of England. But in just a few hours' time, he will use his Luftwaffe Air Force to try and crush the RAF once and for all. This time, right across the country. At a top-secret location in West London, 19-year-old Joan Fanshawe is arriving for the early shift.
I'm heading 18 metres, or 60 feet, beneath the London suburb of Uxbridge. It's not an assuming location, but it would play a crucial role in the Battle of Britain. This is the operations room for the southeast of England. It's known as the 11 Group Bunker, and it's one of four nerve centres from which the Battle of Britain was fought. It was here that Fighter Command were able to track the course of the battle minute by minute and send aircraft into the skies to meet the Nazi attacks.
Joan Fanshawe is one of around 50 RAF personnel on the early shift in the bunker on the 15th of August. She's been secretly keeping a diary of her hours in the ops room.
July the 4th is when she joined.
Yeah.
And within 2 weeks, she is sent to Uxbridge.
So was Joan one of the first women who was
plotters,
a plotter?
They were the first group. A week before she joins up, this is July the 5th, the whole day dominated by my thoughts of having my hair cut off tomorrow.
It's a terrible wrench, for having had it long all my life and being my chief attraction, I shall feel rather as if I've lost my individuality without it.
Intercept at Angel.
Joan's diary also tells us about life on the front line.
I didn't think that anyone was allowed to keep a diary while...
This is fairly careful what information goes in there.
Right.
You don't hear anything about what's really going on in there.
Yeah.
But you know she's at Uxbridge, and you know she goes underground.
Right.
Which maybe would be more information that would want to fall into other people's hands. I don't know.
Joan is a member of the WAF. And according to the recruiting brochure, her official job title is Clerk, Special Duties. But she's actually a plotter.
She stood on this very spot, and her job was to look after the space between Dover and Calais on this map. She would listen for incoming intelligence and then plot the position of enemy aircraft using these blocks, which represented Luftwaffe raids. And this one here represented British RAF squadrons. Once it was all plotted, that would give her commanders a picture of what was going on in the air.
We know about her shift on the 15th of August because she writes about it in her diary.
Got up early to go on duty at 6:45. We were not really terribly busy till the end of the watch when things started to happen.
Joan's shift started quietly. The weather was poor. It was too cloudy for the attacks to begin. But that wouldn't last long.
Also playing a waiting game early that morning are hundreds of RAF pilots up and down the country, including a 28-year-old Scottish pilot at RAF Drem in East Lothian, Scotland. Flight Lieutenant Archie McKellar has already been in the RAF for 4 years. Now he's trying to catch a little sleep after getting back from his night patrol at 4:20 a.m. But Archie isn't a typical pilot. I've come to Glasgow to find out more. So tell me a little bit about him.
Well, there was John and Margaret, that was his mother and father, mm-hmm. and they wanted them to go into the family business, bustling construction, and he didn't want to do that. Archie wanted to fly.
Right, it was a working-class family,
yeah.
So sort of flying was quite a big dream, really, for a young man like this.
It was a dream, it's something he wanted to do.
Yeah.
He decided, I'm going to fly without my parents knowing about this. A typical kind of McKellar thing.
Is it?
Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah.
Were you the same?
Similar things, yes.
Archie grew up in this former tenement building in Paisley, not the normal background of a pilot.
So he became a plasterer's apprentice with his dad. Given that he did come from this quite modest background, how would he have been able to afford flying lessons?
He saved his wages and went off and secretly
and snuck off.
Yeah.
To go and learn.
To fly, and that neither of them were aware. They didn't know he was flying at all, but he used to fly over the house and waggle the wings of the plane.
Archie learned to fly at the Scottish Flying Club. In 1936, he was talent spotted as a promising pilot and invited to join the RAF.
How much were you as a family aware of Archie and what he did?
Well, I wasn't aware until I was a wee bit older, and then I found out, and he became one of my heroes.
Archie's impact as a pilot during the Second World War was almost instantaneous. Just weeks after the war began, he was the first pilot to shoot down a Nazi bomber over Britain. This photo is the actual scene. He later became an ace in a day, destroying 5 enemy aircraft in 24 hours. But for now, on the morning of the 15th of August, Archie is waiting for the enemy to arrive.
...11:10 a.m. The clouds clear, and there's a blue sky over Kent. Then, blips appear on the radar.
The enemy are approaching from over Calais, around 20 miles away from British shores. They can be over targets in southeast England in less than 20 minutes.
It's the first wave of an enormous Luftwaffe raid. The force includes 50 bombers, each carrying up to 1,000 pounds of bombs. Their objective? To destroy Britain's airfields. Protecting the German bombers are dozens of small, fast and deadly fighter planes. The RAF must intercept the raid before it reaches its targets. Every second counts. The largest force seen in the battle so far is about to hit Britain. It's 11:10 a.m. on the 15th of August 1940. The Battle of Britain has been raging for 5 weeks. But today, a massive force of Luftwaffe bombers is crossing the Channel to wipe out the RAF once and for all. At air bases, young pilots are waiting for the call to scramble. Among them is William Hopkin of 54 Squadron at RAF Hornchurch. His job is to patrol the Kent coast in his Spitfire. I've tracked down their lost airfield. It's just parkland today, but that morning it was on the front line of Britain's defence.
This was the airfield at RAF Hornchurch. On the morning of the 15th of August, it's very possible that William Hopkin was waiting just over there in the cockpit of his Spitfire, ready for the signal to take off and engage the enemy.
William is the son of a vicar from Bedfordshire. His story has never been told before. I'm meeting someone very close to him, his son, Simon Hopkin.
There's my father. He joined the RAF at the beginning of 1939.
How old was he?
He was 18. He had literally just started his training when war was declared. He was the youngest of three brothers. The middle brother, Alan, he joined the Air Force in 38. And Alan had just got his wings and flew his Spitfire over the rectory. And Grandpa and Mother and my father came outside to watch it. I suspect that was probably a catalyst,
yeah.
You know, to my father thinking, yeah, this is what I should be doing, I think. So he then joined up.
Simon has a rare artefact, the pilot's logbook that belonged to his father, where he wrote up all his action.
The opening line, when he's literally first time in the air as a trainee in July 39, his brother Alan is with him as the trained pilot. And so the first line in my father's flying logbook is signed off by his elder brother.
But the two brothers would not be flying together for long.
Tragically, Alan was lost on the opening day of the Battle of Britain. And so there's a tragic sort of three-liner in my father's logbook, which says,
Alan lost in Bristol Blenheim in enemy territory while night bombing Cherbourg.
Yeah, about night Cherbourg. So you've now got his elder brother, who obviously he hugely looked up to, who was perhaps the inspiration for him joining the Air Force. And now he's gone, and we're just about to start the Battle of Britain.
William Hopkin has only been with an operational squadron for 3 months, and he's never shot down an enemy aircraft before. I want to know what he must have been feeling on that morning. Fighter pilot Air Marshal Cliff Spink, who flew in the RAF for 30 years, is giving me the chance to find out.
How did those young pilots even get up out of their seats and pick their parachutes up?
It's very difficult to imagine or put yourself in the position of someone like that. They would have not only known that a lot of pilots not coming back, but there's a level of expectation. He's not wanting to let down either himself, but particularly his comrades. And of course, these young men like William, they either survive the next few days and then will probably survive a lot longer.
Yeah.
Or actually got shot down and killed very early on.
The task ahead weighs heavily on 19-year-old William as he gets ready for action on the 15th of August.
So I just slot myself in like that.
I'm going to take to the skies in a Spitfire, just as he would have done on that morning.
Now, I'm feeling very secure because you're so tightly in, but what's protecting me? There's no padding, you know, I'm seeing right into the inner works of the aircraft. It seems to me that if somebody shot it, it would just go straight through.
You're smack on. This is relatively thin aluminium. Normally, if anyone's going to shoot at you, he's going to come from behind. So they had armour plate protecting your head on your back. But in truth, there was very little protection for the pilot.
As William Hopkins straps in, he knows what he is expected to do.
He would be flying with his either his flight commander or his section leader in a support configuration. They used to say stick, search, and report. In other words, stick to your leader, search around for other enemy aeroplanes, and then report what you see.
At 11:18, William is ready to take off from his base in Hornchurch with 54 Squadron. It's going to be a long day. Sitting here in a Spitfire, I'm trying to imagine what it must have been like for him in that moment. But for William Hopkin and 54 Squadron, combat is just moments away.
At 11:30, the Luftwaffe raiders are nearing their first target, the airbase at Hawkinge on the Kent coast. Amongst them are a group of 50 deadly dive bombers. 54 Squadron, including William Hopkin, meet the enemy and are ordered to engage. We're very lucky to have William's personal account of the fighting.
He reports, "I followed Blue Leader into the attack when we engaged some Ju-87 dive bombing between Dover and Hawkinge.
I got on the tail of one and managed to fire a fairly long burst using 1,600 rounds and saw the enemy aircraft dive away steeply with smoke coming out of it."
It's William's first successful score against the enemy.
Not bad for a young man who's relatively new to combat.
But for 54 Squadron, the raid isn't over yet. Leading the German fighter planes engaging William and his comrades on the 15th of August is a formidable opponent, Luftwaffe ace Adolf Galland. At 28 years old, Galland has been in the Luftwaffe for over 6 years. And will stop at nothing to take down the RAF. He is so successful, the Nazi high command make propaganda films about him.
Here we have a set of pictures which have never been seen on television before and which display the character of Galland.
You get a sense of the cocked hat there.
He always cocked it. And even when he was told, "Straighten your hat," off it went again at a cock the moment he'd straightened it.
There's something of the maverick about him, isn't
there? There is. Well, Galland subscribed to the heroic view of the German fighter pilot, and he took that sense of deep commitment, very personal pride, but very independent viewpoint into combat with him, with the complete and utter conviction that he could do what he set himself to do.
By the morning of the 15th of August 1940, Adolf Galland has already shot down over 17 Allied aircraft. And now he's in the skies over Kent. William Hopkin and the pilots of 54 Squadron are in his sights.
But they have their very own ace. Al Deer is an extremely experienced pilot. He's only 22, but he's already been decorated by King George VI for his bravery. Al Deer spots the fighter planes in Adolf Galland's formation and climbs steeply to engage them.
He gets within 300 yards of them and opens fire. The 8 machine guns mounted on the wing score a direct hit.
But it's not Galland. He is now ready to make his move. Galland swoops through the aircraft of 54 Squadron. Looping around, he gets on the tail of one, spraying it with shells. The Spitfire plummets to Earth. It's flown by 25-year-old Polish pilot Wojciech Klozeniski. He's only been in action for 3 days. He manages to bail out, but it will take him over 2 years to recover from his injuries, and he will never fly in combat again. But Galland isn't finished yet. He dies on a Spitfire belonging to 23-year-old Norman Lawrence, who's desperately trying to regroup with 54 Squadron. The plane bursts into flames. Astonishingly, Lawrence survives. For now, Galland has finished and heads back to Calais. William Hopkin and Al Deer have come through, but they have watched two of their friends from 54 Squadron fall. The life expectancy for an RAF pilot in the Battle of Britain was just 4 weeks. It's been a morning of intense fighting for the pilots and ground crew, but it's far from over. The morning of the 15th of August 1940 has seen high drama over the southeast coast of England as Luftwaffe fighters and bombers struck in their hundreds. William Hopkin and Al Deer of 54 Squadron have survived. In the north, all is quiet, and pilot Archie McKellar is waiting for action. For WAF Joan Fanshawe, it's been a tense and eventful end to her watch. As the dust settles on the morning's raid, the commanders here in the Uxbridge bunker survey the destruction. The Luftwaffe has done serious damage to two airfields on the Kent coast, Lynn and Hawkinge. But all of their Spitfires and Hurricanes were able to get airborne before the enemy bombers arrived, meaning not one British fighter was destroyed on the ground. For Hitler's Air Force, it's been a disappointing morning. Midday. No sooner is the morning raid over than something even more sinister is spotted on the radar. Flying from a base in Nazi-occupied Norway, a huge enemy raid is approaching from across the North Sea. Hitler's planes are heading for the north, and Scottish pilot Archie McKellar is in the firing line. Luftwaffe commanders had assumed that the RAF would send all its fighter pilots down south to protect the south coast against the Nazi raids coming over from France. They hoped that the north of England would be left vulnerable. And so they planned to launch a surprise attack there on the 15th of August. At 12:30, over 100 German planes appear in the skies above Northumberland. Despite the enormous numbers of enemy aircraft, the RAF spot the raids nice and early and are able to get their planes into the sky in plenty of time. When the enemy arrive, the RAF are waiting for them. Three RAF squadrons are in the skies over the north, including 605 Squadron. 28-year-old Archie McKellar is their flight leader. At 1:10, the enemy planes are swarming over Newcastle. Archie spots the formation and orders his men to follow him in a dive attack. He gets on the tail of one German and, using a quarter of his bullets, sends it spiraling. But he was too busy to notice the enemy coming up from behind him. It fires on Archie, hitting him in the wings. Archie keeps flying, diving on the leader of the Luftwaffe formation and shooting him down, before streaking after a lone straggler and sending him crashing into the sea. He later wrote to his mother describing the raid.
"Dearest little mother, I'm very well and very pleased with myself. On Thursday, I saw 70 to 80 nasties in one big formation. Whipped into them with my flight. I got three down. Everyone gave the nasties the fright of their lives. I was very proud. All my love, Sonny."
It's an incredible result, but not unusual for an exceptional pilot such as Archie. In fact, his talents are so impressive that the RAF actually feature him in a booklet used to recruit new pilots.
So each squadron would have almost like a poster boy as somebody, you know, you need to be like him. There he is, squadron leader Archibald A. McKellar. But listen to this is just wonderful. "There's no room for the slacker. The discipline is strict. Strive to emulate the McKellar tradition." You know, he was the person they wanted everybody to be like.
He was just an incredible guy. There's stories I've heard of him going up into the skies and looking for stray planes before breakfast. as if, you know, "I've heard there's stray planes,
yeah,
and I'm going up to see if there's anything I can find."
But what's really lovely about this booklet is it gives a real insight. Always, he was immaculate. He shaved and groomed himself every morning, even during the Battle of Britain. He insisted on his squadron following his example. "If I have to die, I want to die clean," he remarked to his colleague. Was your dad like that?
My father's like that, yes.
Really?
To this day, yeah, every morning, and a shirt and tie on.
For the McKellar family, sharing Archie's story has always been extremely important.
Do you feel proud of him?
Oh, very. Very. I always ask people, have you ever heard of Archie McKellar? They've all heard of the Battle of Britain, but they've never heard of Archie McKellar. It's just an amazing story to achieve so much.
In 1945, Archie returns to base. His actions over Newcastle that afternoon are part of a strong response from the RAF. Destroyed German aircraft lie strewn across the ground. The Luftwaffe's attack on the north is a disaster. Despite having fewer planes, the RAF fends off the enemy raids. It's down to Fighter Command's ingenious intelligence system, and the bunker in Uxbridge, where WAF Joan Fanshawe works, is a key piece of the puzzle.
If you look down at the map closely, those little red lines you see in circles around the coast there are showing the range of the radar. And that gives you about a 20-minute warning, so you know when hostile raids are coming in.
In 1940, radar is a brand new, top-secret technology, using radio waves to detect aircraft over the channel. But it has a drawback. Once the planes have passed inland over the radar towers, they become invisible. The solution is distinctly low-tech.
You've got these guys sitting in 1,500 observer corps posts tracking the aircraft as they came over. They'd have some instruments for estimating height, and they'd be sending the information back to headquarters.
So now the commanders here can see what the radar's telling them and what all these observers are telling them. The details of the enemy aircraft are phoned through to the bunker and placed on wooden blocks, marked H for hostile, with the number of aircraft in the raid. It's Joan Fanshawe's job to plot these enemy aircraft on the map.
10 aircraft at 15.
Royal Air Force were very keen on getting women involved, wanted to get as many women as it could, doing as many jobs as possible.
So these women that are moving the plots around, like Joan, are a kind of critical part of this machine.
Oh, yeah.
Commanders then have a complete picture of the situation and can send the most appropriate squadron to meet the enemy.
602, 213, squadrons to readiness.
Now, the Germans had no idea this was here and no idea this system existed.
No. I think you could describe this as our secret weapon.
For Joan, being part of this crucial system is not an easy task. On the 15th of August, after her morning watch ends, we can see from her diary that she's flagging.
I lay down a bit after lunch, feeling rather tired.
It was intense concentration when it got busy, and it sounds very tiring. They were on four-hour watches, but I think when they came off it, they were extremely tired.
But despite the fatigue and seeing some of the worst fighting of the battle so far, Joan is still able to find some light relief.
Had a drill after the watch, and we had to do imaginary saluting of officers to each other. We nearly died with laughter.
We should remember she'd only been in the RAF, what, about six weeks
yes.
by then, so yeah. It was new, and even how to salute was not necessarily automatic
yeah.
stuff, and it was still very funny for them.
By mid-afternoon, Joan is off her watch, and the early afternoon raids on the north of England die down. But the RAF isn't able to rest. Raid upon raid of hundreds of enemy aircraft flood the skies in the southeast. Just after 3 p.m, William Hopkin is in the air again to intercept one of the multiple incoming enemy attacks. From his pilot's logbook, we can see that it's the fourth time he's been up today.
You're on call 16, 17, 18 hours a day, and within that day, day in and day out, you're up 3, 4, 5, 6 missions a day. So just the tiredness, but the strain of the fear and of the fatigue must have been extraordinary.
Despite the incredible strain put on the pilots, they keep flying day after day, week after week.
And you look at some of them relaxing in 54 Squadron here. I think it's that bond, you know, that camaraderie that comes through, that when you are part of a fighting unit, you haven't been born together, but a lot of you trained together, you fought together, you socialised together, you've seen a lot of tragedy together. You look at the names of those relaxing on the grass, and of the four pilots mentioned there, three were lost during the battle.
RIP,
yeah.
Zero aircraft at
50. 1600 hours. William's movements in the air are being plotted in the Uxbridge bunker, but not by 19-year-old Joan Fanshawe, who has now left the building. It's been an exhausting day. But looking at her diary, we can see that Joan is somehow able to forget about work.
At 4, I dashed off down the station and caught the tube and met Pat Wickens, who was a family friend. We had tea. And
I thoroughly enjoyed myself. I met Jocelyn coming back in the train. We had a snack, and then the air raid siren went. We absolutely dashed back on my bike.
Poor Jocelyn, running. And then by the end of the day, she's saying, pretty much been on watch. We've done damn near over 16 hours today. And that is this extraordinary double life, isn't it, of someone doing this incredible job, really intense, and then going for tea in London.
Going for tea and having a giggle with her girlfriend.
Yeah. Life went on, and she would say that, and it definitely comes over in her diaries. It goes from these exhausted times to sometimes to boredom, and you'd think, really, during the Battle of Britain, there were calms between the storm.
Yeah.
One pilot who so far managed to avoid the storms today is Peter Cumley. He's based at RAF Exeter in the West Country with 87 Squadron. His Battle of Britain has been spent patrolling the south coast, protecting nearby bases from any Luftwaffe attacks. But as it's outside the main hotspot of the southeast of England, the fighting has been less intense. I'm meeting his Canadian nephew, Richard Cumley.
This is my Uncle Peter as a RAF pilot.
Teenager.
Yeah, 18 years old. That's him with his cap on, full uniform.
Peter was one of five siblings growing up in rural Gloucestershire.
You know, there's my father. He's the little guy in the middle.
Sweet little picture.
Yeah. That one's my uncle Peter.
They did not grow up in the lap of luxury.
No. They were born and raised in Gloucestershire until they moved to Yorkshire. My grandfather wanted to be a farmer. He had a farm until he lost it, and then he went to work for the government. But they did go to boarding school.
Peter spent his carefree summers away from boarding school, playing cricket and fishing.
My grandmother made Peter sound like a really good sport about a lot of things. He really wanted to try and make other people happy.
But it was his adventurous personality that made the RAF his natural calling.
There's nobody in our family tree who preceded him in the RAF. He just loved the idea of flying. So this is his license.
So that is 13th of March, 1939. So it's just before his 18th birthday. So he's 17 when he's...
Yeah.
So he obviously had an aptitude for flying.
Yes, he did. He picked it up pretty quick.
So Peter was a good pilot.
You know, before August 15th, he had already shot down four before that date.
Despite the calm start in the West Country, for Peter Cumley, the day won't remain quiet for long. 17:20. RAF pilots have been in the skies fighting the enemy for the past 6 hours. But it's not over yet. Suddenly, a large raid appears, heading for the Royal Navy base at Portland, on the coast of Dorset. 19-year-old Peter Cumley is scrambled with 87 Squadron. He's about to find himself right in the thick of the... 17:25 on the 15th of August. It's been a day of non-stop combat across the whole of Britain. But the action isn't finished yet. Now the West Coast is under attack, and 19-year-old pilot Peter Cumley is in the air. He's heading to Portland to defend the naval base against Luftwaffe bombers. The National Archives at Kew hold a combat record for Peter's flight. I've come to find out exactly what happened that evening with his nephew. Let's look up the date for the 15th of August. This is in the afternoon by this stage.
At about 17:30, there was a panic takeoff by both squadrons. What was described as the fiercest dogfight yet experienced then took place. The results of this attack on Portland were as follows. PO, Pilot Officer Cumley, 1 ME-110, destroyed.
That's your uncle?
Yeah.
That's his fifth aircraft destroyed in the war so far.
Yeah.
Peter destroys an enemy aircraft, a huge boost to his squadron. But the combat report also reveals the details of the moment that comes next. And can you read this bit out here?
Our casualties were squadron leader Lovell Gregg and pilot officer... Cumley, killed. P.O. Cumley was able to shoot down an ME-110 into the sea, but unfortunately, another was on his tail, and he followed his victim into the water. I guess he takes one out before... He takes one more out before they take him out. I had hoped when I read it that he went quickly. He didn't end up freezing to death in the channel like some pilots did.
Shortly after the 15th of August, Peter's friend and commander, Flight Lieutenant Ian Gleed, writes to Peter's father.
This is a note he gets back from...
Dear Mr. Cumley, thank you for your letter. One of my pilots saw Peter's plane hit the sea about 10 miles off Portland He had not used his parachute. After the battle, two other planes and myself searched the area but found nothing. It is with very deep sympathy and sorrow that I must tell you that in my opinion, there is very little chance of Peter being still alive. I cannot tell you how much we all miss him. Yours sincerely, Gleed, Flight Lieutenant.
Yeah.
They were friends.
So it's not an overstatement when he says here how much he missed him. By 1820, the raid over Portland is over. Several enemy planes are downed, but the RAF has suffered too. They can't keep sustaining these losses. It's been the most intense day of the Battle of Britain so far. William Hopkin is probably in the pub, unwinding with his fellow pilots by now. He scored his first hit against the enemy, but 54 Squadron has been badly shaken. Two pilots have been gunned down. The man responsible is Luftwaffe ace Adolf Galland, who is back in Calais, awaiting another day of combat. Elsewhere in Uxbridge, Joan Fanshawe is returning to the bunker for her night shift. In Scotland, Archie McKellar is celebrating shooting down three Luftwaffe bombers in one encounter. He's been fortunate, but others have not been so lucky.
Dear Mr. Cumley, thank you for your letter. One of my pilots saw Peter's plane hit the sea about 10 miles off Portland. He had not used his parachute.
In the 11 group bunker at Uxbridge, commanders take stock.
The Luftwaffe has flown 2,000 sorties. That's twice as many as the RAF, but they've lost 78 aircraft. It was their attack on the north of England that was particularly costly, with 88 of their aircrew either missing or dead. It would be the last time that the Luftwaffe would attempt such large-scale daylight raids on the north.
The RAF have fared better, but there have still been losses. 45 aircraft destroyed, 13 damaged, and 17 pilots killed. But the day's fighting has shown that the squadrons of 11 Group, controlled from this bunker, have been able to hold their own against superior numbers of enemy aircraft.
Churchill has been watching the day's events unfold back at base, 12 miles away at Bentley Priory.
When Churchill left Fighter Command HQ that evening, he described the 15th of August 1940 as one of the greatest days in history. But for the Luftwaffe, who had failed in their bid to destroy the RAF, the 15th of August became known as Black Thursday.
The following day, Churchill commented to a friend that never in the field of human conflict had so much been owed by so many to so few. 4 days later, he repeated that phrase in Parliament in what would become his most famous speech. But had Winston Churchill spoken too soon? Tomorrow night, we discover what happens when Britain stands on the brink of defeat.
The worst thing was seeing the planes approaching, but not knowing until the last minute what their target was.
Holy smoke, three missing, and you realise the others are crying as well.
We crash forward to the 30th of August, 1940. Can the nation survive the most intense day of fighting?
I am seeing this hurricane heading literally straight for our windscreen.